So for the last week, I've been using Xiaomi's Mi Notebook Pro. It's their latest model, which is 15.6 inches with a 1080p display, 8th generation Core i5 or i7 CPU options, up to 16 gigabytes of RAM, and 256 gigabytes of storage with a spare SATA 3 or NVMe slot in there. It's got a 60 watt hour battery, wireless AC, which is the Intel 8265 chip, very powerful, very fast. Do like the performance of it, and it also has a touchpad you can see down here that is rather large, works really well. It's a precision one with full control over the gestures using Windows options, that it does incorporate a fingerprint reader, which also works pretty much flawlessly, unlocking Windows and going straight to desktop in a matter of seconds. So much quicker than typing in a password. Now the keyboard has 1.3 millimeters of travel, very decent keyboard. I've been typing on it quite a bit, using it the whole time, and I must say, I really do like it. It's a lot better than the 13-inch version's keyboard, which is not a bad keyboard, but this really steps things up. It has a better feel to it. The keys aren't completely flat, and they just spaced out a little bit more, making it more comfortable, and I find that I have less typos on this keyboard and can type quite a bit faster. So on the bottom, we have this grill here for the intake, so very similar to the 13-inch version. Two loudspeakers, which I'll give you a sample of later on in this review. The screen hinge itself, quite firm. I've noticed that it's better than the 13-inch version, which loosened up a little bit after 6 months of use, and after 1 year with my 12-inch version, feels a little bit more looser, but this, they have improved. It feels a lot firmer, so they're listening to the complaints, and the lid itself is really quite firm there, and it does weigh 2 kilos, so a lot heavier than the 13-inch version. So for ports on the right-hand side, we have two USB 3.1 ports on them. Now one of them only supports video out and charging. That's the one closest to the status LED there. So the status LED will light up green once fully charged. And to fully charge it takes about an hour and 50 minutes. It is very quick for a 60 watt hour battery. In 30 minutes, you can get right up to 50% battery. And you'll also notice an SD card reader there. Now that SD card reader, I have a bit of a complaint with, that it does end up sticking out the SDs when you insert them. They don't fully go in and has a maximum read and write speed of only 30 megabytes per second, which isn't great. Now on the left-hand side, we've got two USB 3 ports running at full speed, support external hard drives. We also have a 3.5 millimeter headphone jack that is clear, the output of audio from that, and supports microphones. The HDMI out is a little disappointing on this because what I've found is that it does not support 60 Hertz 4K. It's only HDMI 1.4 spec and not 2.0, which I feel it should have been. We're also lacking a Thunderbolt 3 port on this laptop. You'll see the screen reclines to the maximum position like that, which isn't bad at all. Now the screen itself is a 1080p panel, and this panel has a coverage of 88% RGB and puts out a maximum of 360 lux. Overall, it's a nice 1080p panel they've put on there, but of course at 15.6 inches, if you look at it really close, you can see pixels here. Ideally, I would have liked to have seen at least a 1440p screen. So the build of it in general is excellent. Very well done here. There's no logos on the top of the lid, as you'll see, so very plain and minimalistic design that I happen to like. So gaining access to the internals isn't too difficult. We have 9T5 Torx screws. Remove all them, there's one hidden just under the foot in the middle here. And then you just pry off the rear case, which is a little difficult to pry off at first, but use a guitar pick, credit card, or a pry tool. So we have the original SSD in here that they ship with this is a Samsung PM961. Now you can replace this if you want with something a little faster like a Samsung 960 Pro or Evo. And if you wanted to, you could add a second SSD in the spare slot that it also has. Note that the spare drive isn't limited to just SATA 3. You can install a faster NVMe drive, for example, like a Samsung 960 Evo or Pro. Now one minor little problem here that I have encountered is the read speeds on both of those SSD slots. So both of the ports I have confirmed are running at proper PCIe times 4 speeds, because I've used Samsung Magician to confirm this, and other software as well, so that's not the issue. I also know because the write speeds here are running at the full speeds I get from my desktop PC. So when I inserted this SSD and the other one in my tower PC, I could get read rates of 3000 megabytes per second. However, here you can see we're getting approximately 1800 megabytes per second. So we're missing out on quite a bit of speed there on the read rates, but not on the writes, which is unusual. So I think it might just be down to drivers. Hopefully later on we're going to get a software update or some driver updates that will correct this problem. Now when it comes to the system performance, programs like Photoshop run perfectly fine, as you'd expect for an i5, in fact performance really of an i7, which I will show you later on how to get this one to perform like an i7-7700HQ. But right here I'm running everything stock when it comes to the power limits and everything, and I'm editing a 4K video, and you'll see that the timeline here, this is all running at real time. There's no problem here. This is a clip that is approximately about 10 minutes long there, my edit, and really runs quite fast. Now you will have, of course, the fan comes on now and then, kicks in and out. Now encoding performance, we'll check that out now. I'll do a quick test encode. The same exact one I did for the Mi Notebook Air 13. So it will be 1 minute with the YouTube 4K preset, 1 minute of footage, and we'll see how long it takes with the factory, the stock TDP limit, and then tweak to 40 watts. Okay, so that's a minute of footage there, testing code number one. And I'll also time this here, and we'll see how long it takes for it to export with the standard TDP here, which is the 15 watts of power limit. So we'll get this underway now. So that's just finishing up now. And there we go, took 5 minutes. And on the Mi Notebook Air, that took approximately 6 minutes. So we're only 1 minute faster here on the 4K encoding times. However, what I'm gonna do now is set the TDP over in Intel Extreme Tuning Utility. I'm gonna change this over to 45 watts, so the same exact wattage now as the i7-7700. And that also has an undervolt here that should be applied to, that I can get away with, and it's still very stable with that. And now we'll have a look at the difference in doing that same encode. So same length, same settings. So that just finished up now at 3 minutes and 19 seconds, shaving almost 2 minutes off that time, and more or less about as fast as my i7-7700HQ gaming laptop. So really impressive encoding times there when you tweak up that power limit. And if we have a look at the temperatures here, so what did thermals get up to? The CPU did not go over 74 degrees there with all that encoding and testing I've been doing in the last 58 minutes. So right up the top we have a webcam. Now when it's on you see a little tiny little status LED that will light up. This audio is also being recorded by the dual array microphones either side of that webcam. Now the quality of the webcam itself you can see is a little bit grainy, a little bit pixelated. It's not particularly good. However, the audio quality I would rate as above average, better than most other notebooks I have tested out, certainly the cheaper ones.
It is. And that's just a quick start guide there.
So when it comes to streaming in 4K, so YouTube here perfectly fine, the wireless can keep up, and it's using the VP9 codec you can see here. It runs flawlessly there, multitasking as well, so a lot going on. I still have that video there in the background, Edge. You can have various different things open, so it's all very fast at changing and swapping between all your different applications. Really no issue there with that whatsoever when it comes to performance. It's as quick as any other Core i5 8th generation laptop. Now when it comes to wireless performance, it's excellent. So is the range. I mean, it is really good. I am in the apartment here. Anywhere in the apartment, I'm getting pretty much the maximum speeds out of my 300 megabit router here. Unfortunately, I can't do a file transfer test. My router doesn't permit me to do this. I'll have to set that up in the future, but it is really good, the results of this. So it's got a 2x2 antenna setup, and the chipset is the wireless AC from Intel. 8265 is one of the more recent ones, and it is really, really good. And now having a look at benchmarks here. So you can use these benchmarks to gauge against your own laptop, your notebook, to see if it's faster or slower. This is Geekbench 4. Very good multi-score here. Multi-core score. This turns out to be approximately twice as fast as the Mi Notebook Air 13. That's the revised 2017 model with the i5-7200U. Now, the reason behind this is because it's got two more cores, okay? So that version, the 13-inch version, is only a dual core with four threads. This is quad core with eight threads. So that's why we're seeing such good scores here. The OpenCL score, very similar to the 13-inch model, but it's around about 2,000 to 3,000 points higher there, probably aided by the fact that maybe cooling's just a little bit better on this model, and that is why the score's higher there. Now, if we have a look at Firestrike, this is a gaming benchmark, of course. That's a very low score if this was a gaming notebook. Really low. Not good at all. However, you know, for a MX150, this isn't too bad. The physics score that you can see is really good. Now, if we do apply an overclock to the GPU, so this is the boost we get here, which does increase approximately about 15% in this particular benchmark. Now, that same result of the overclock here is about 30% difference when you have a look at Heaven. So in Heaven, we've got a score of 587. And then with the overclock and also the CPU tweak, it then goes up to 770, which is not bad at all. Now, Cinebench, the stock score is 571 CB. And then when you do go into Intel's Extreme Tuning Utility, apply 40 watts here to the power limits and the slight undervolt, which I've done, you can see, then that score will go up here to 736, which is in fact faster than my i7-7700HQ gaming laptop. So that score there is really impressive, and it will hold those turbos 3.4 on all four cores for as long as you want. Now, you've seen from those gaming benchmarks like Firestrike that this is not a powerful gaming laptop. This, in fact, is not a gaming laptop. Don't mistake that. This is really only for more like work or business use. Not really designed for gaming. But however, as you'll see, if you've seen my gaming review, we can play a lot of top titles. So AAA titles can run in 1080p as long as you set things to low settings. Now, more demanding titles that I tested out like Witcher 3 will require you to drop the resolution down to 720p, and then it was perfectly fine and playable, again, as long as you keep things on low there. Now, when it came to temperatures, we got up to 82 degrees on the CPU, and it did not go over 70 on the GPU, and that was also with the overclock applied. So if you're not overclocking, the GPU normally hovers about 64 degrees, and then the CPU about 78 degrees maximum. So thermals have improved on the outside of this model compared to the 13-inch version. That got up to 50 degrees Celsius, which I found to be way too hot. At the moment, after 30 minutes of pushing the system very hard, both stress testing the CPU and GPU, it's up to about 42 degrees here. The highest I have seen it get is 45 degrees after about an hour and a half of gaming. So the temperatures, yes, better. Palm rest, about 28 degrees normally. Here it's about 25. So really, the heat I feel on this model isn't an issue because they have improved the cooling. Now, the laptop does get loud under full load. I'll give you a sample of that with pushing it really hard on both the GPU and CPU. So we have some Harman Infinity speakers on this, and I must say they do sound excellent, better than some gaming laptops with little subs in them. So let's have a listen to them. So my test here of Linux, this is Manjaro build number 17.0.5, and of course that has more or less the latest kind of kernels and everything's working perfectly fine here. So the drivers for things like the touchpad, no issues with that. That is working. Screen shortcuts for brightness control, using the keyboard, working. Audio as well, completely working there. Wireless, of course, I'm connected up to that, so no problems there. The only thing I had to do was in the BIOS, you must add a password first before you can disable secure boot and then boot your live Linux distros, your USB pen drives and that there. But great to see, and it performs really well, super fast too. So what about my final opinion now of this laptop? I think it's brilliant. I really do like this. I'm going to be keeping this one here. I'm not going to be keeping the 13-inch version. This is much more powerful. I'm impressed with the performance once I increase that TDP, so I can boost it up to perform exactly like the i7-7700HQ, which is great. So it encodes my video very fast. It is lacking, of course, this particular option, the 16 gigabytes of RAM. I do feel that is overpriced right now for the i7 16 gigabyte option. It's really way too expensive. You have to pay an additional $300 to $400 for it. So the display is decent. It's not perfect. I would have preferred a 1440p screen on this, and I would have really liked them to have put Thunderbolt 3 on this and perhaps put an NVIDIA 1050. Maybe they will revise this model next year or the end of this year and add those options. It's certainly doable. They can do it, I believe. Okay, the SD card reader. They've got it on there, which is great. I can transfer my files over, but at a slow 30 megabytes per second. I really wish that was faster, and I wish that the SD card would click right in so we don't risk damaging or breaking it if you left it in there putting in a backpack. Not that you would, really. The other thing is battery life could be a little bit better. The heat as well. It does get a little bit warm. 45 degrees I don't feel is a deal breaker. A lot of other laptops will also get up to that temperature that is thin as this one right here. And the other, probably very minor, is the webcam could be a little bit better. And of course, the HDMI. It's only HDMI 1.4 spec. It should be HDMI 2.0 to output a full 60 Hertz 4K. So that is really it. Apart from that, this is a fantastic notebook here. Great to see that we can boost the performance with my little tweak. If you haven't seen the video for that, please check it out. And also check out my extended gaming review of this notebook here. You'll see that it probably will surprise you that you can get away with playing some popular titles at decent frame rates, just lowering the settings a little there. Thank you so much for watching this review. Do hope to see you back in the channel with more up and coming reviews on tech out of China. Bye for now.